So for those of you who just walked in, this is Hacked Cars, Stolen Identities, and Short-Circuited Pacemakers. If you did not intend on being in this room, that's what we're talking about, and hopefully it's enticing enough that you'll remain and stay here. This is the cybersecurity session. My name is Sian Goldovsky. I'm a senior analyst on the investments team at Our Crowd, and I am the cyber and AI lead. So to try to set the mood, I'm actually going to instill a little bit of fear in you guys by playing these two videos.
Well, because I pretty much disagree with everything you say and do. That's very funny. You got some balls, Brody, I'll give you that. I'm not joking.
Okay, so that's terrifying. That was a connected medical device in a fictional show where they were trying to show what a potential hack can do in terms of impact. Here's another slightly more less terrifying hacking video.
Hi, this is Sam from Bank of eSecurity Fraud Department. Unfortunately, I have to inform you that your account's been compromised.
What? What happened?
First, before I can answer any questions, I need to verify some information. Are you still at 306 Hawthorne Avenue?
Yes, apartment 2C.
Great. And your security question, favorite baseball team?
Yankees. I don't remember this being a security
question. And lastly, your pet's name?
Flipper. Who am I speaking to? Can I get your name and number?
With those details, plus a dictionary brute force attack, it'll take my program maybe 2 minutes to crack his password.
That was an example of a social hacking attempt. And so sometimes the weakest link is actually the person. I'm going to run you through a little bit of what happened in 2018. It's actually been a record year in the cybersecurity segment in terms of mergers and acquisitions. Over $15.5 billion have been disclosed over 183 transactions in terms of acquisitions in the cyberspace. Venture capital has invested $6.2 billion in cybersecurity companies, which is all the positive things, but also the negative things happen. So in terms of data breaches, we've seen over 1,000 breaches in the United States alone, with the top five totaling over 850 million users' data combined, where each one of those pieces of data on average in the United States costs about $233 to the company. So this is very significant. We've seen some humongous exits. So Duo was acquired by Cisco for $2.4 billion. Imperva was acquired for $2.1 billion by Thoma Bravo, which is actually a private equity firm, which is really interesting to see. Don't be freaked out by this. This graph is just to kind of show you guys what's been happening with cybersecurity over time. The black boxes represent the private sector, and the gray represents the public. So as you can see, if you're going with the time, overall it might look like it may have shrunk a bit, but if you're looking at the private, it actually grew tremendously. And the amount of transactions, of course, also jumped up. This is one of the fields where we're lucky enough to have actually had companies go public. So everybody here who's an investor should be really excited about that. And we've been seeing nice multiples, as you can see here, between about the 7 to 8 times revenue for the trailing 12 months. So that's a quick little brief introduction as to what's been happening with cybersecurity. To speak on behalf of one of our companies, we have over here Michael Dick. He's going to be representing C2A. Please come on up and present. You have this microphone. Yeah.
Mike.
Hi, good morning. Can you hear me? Yes. Uh, Hi, I'm Michael Dick from C2A Security, a startup dealing with cybersecurity for in-vehicle cybersecurity. So imagine you rushing to work in the morning, and you get into your car, and you try and start your car, and you get a message on the screen which says, in order to start your car, you have to pay 4,000 euros in bitcoins to a particular organization, and then they'll start your car. If not, then you have to call a tow truck and get it to the garage, and they'll take a week to replace all the software and all the computers in the car. It'll cost you much more than 4,000 euros to do that. Now, this all might sound like science fiction, but it's not. It can happen tomorrow, and if it doesn't happen tomorrow, it'll happen the next day, but it's going to happen. In an average car, there are hundreds of computers. They call them ECUs in a car.
It's pretty.
The hundreds of ECUs in a car. They're all connected in gateway, in networks. And each one of those computers controls safety systems in the car. And that includes the brakes, it includes the steering wheel, it includes the engine. It includes all the systems in the car are controlled by brakes. When a computer actually gets the brakes to work. 90% of cars that are produced today are produced as connected cars. They're connected to the internet, either to services, roadside services, OnStar for General Motors, etc. The cars are open to the internet. Autonomous cars are going to be connected to Wi-Fi all the time because of vehicle-to-vehicle, vehicle-to-infrastructure, which means that if a hacker manages to get into the car, he's got full control of the car. Just about a year and a half ago, SoftBank bought Arm. Arm is a company that makes many microprocessors, and there are hundreds of them in every car. At the annual summit of SoftBank, after they bought Arm, Masayoshi Son, who is the CEO of SoftBank, gave a talk.
It's pretty easy to go hack the car and disable, put the virus, right? And next day, the old virus wake up. In one day, at one given time, let's say 9 a.m. April 2nd, right? 9 a.m. Suddenly, every virus wake up and disable the control of the steering, control of the brake. What happened? Every car go crash on the highway. This will be a chaos. Next 30 years, highway system will be all disabled. This is a real disaster. So every car today, none of the connected cars, none of these cars are encrypted in the chip. This is a pretty serious situation. I shouldn't talk too much. Right? We shouldn't give too much hint to the bad guys. Anyway.
So, this is realistic, and many of the car manufacturers and tier ones, who are the companies that provide systems to the car manufacturers, are now investing a lot of time and effort and thinking about what they're going to do about this, because currently cars have got very large security holes, and this is a risk that can happen tomorrow. So us at C2A have come up with several solutions to be able to protect these cars. In security, there's not one silver bullet that will solve all problems, but you have to have multiple solutions to be able to solve this type of problem. And there is a lot of interest from the car manufacturers and from the tier ones. It's being discussed in legislation. And even on the national level, this is a risk to the country's infrastructure. And therefore, it's becoming more and more discussed on the regulatory front as well. Let's hope that these solutions get implemented quicker rather than in the short term, rather in the long time, to keep us all safe and to be able to keep our families safe. I thank you very much.
Okay, I don't know which mic. Maybe both? Is that clear? Okay, so actually I'd love to invite to stage Gadi. He's come on up. Gadi Mazur is the COO of BioCatch.
Can we have this? It's working, right? So what I'm going to tell you about is called APP, authorized push payment, or vishing. Can we turn this one off? It's actually tied somewhat to what Mike said about the email that he got for his wife. So this is how it goes. Someone, primarily in the UK, usually an older person, gets a phone call saying, we're calling from Sky, the cable company, and you owe us £8. So, you know, they pay with a debit card, not suspecting, and anyway, they're protected with the debit card. They pay £8, and the call is over. 5 minutes later, they get another call from the bank, say, Lloyds, and they say, we're calling from Lloyds. We just blocked a transaction of £8. That was not Sky calling you. That was fraud, and we blocked the transaction. And they say, how did the call go? So the person explains that you know, what they were told, and that they gave the debit card. So then they say, you gave your debit card, so now they know your number, so we will open a safe account for you, a new account, and we'll guide you through transferring all your money to the new account so that the fraudster doesn't have access to your account. And any session that takes 45 minutes, 60 minutes, the fraudsters, of course the fraudster is on the phone, guides the end user on transferring all his life saving, tens of thousands of pounds, to a new account they opened. It's instant payment in the UK, so that money is gone the minute it's in the other account, and that's £250 million fraud modus operandi in the UK in the last year. That's the number one social engineering fraud in the UK. What we do at BioCatch is behavioral biometrics. So we protect banks and credit card issuers by monitoring the sessions, whether over web or mobile device, looking at the behavior of the user, creating a behavioral profile, behavioral biometrics. We all move the mouse differently, type differently, scroll differently, basically allowing the bank to know, say, at the sixth session of that user, that that's indeed the session, and indeed the user that is engaged with that session, and not someone that took over. We use that for authentication of the user, so that the bank doesn't need to send you SMS codes for everything that you do on the site. We do that for account takeover prevention, so if someone did get a hold of your credentials, we will tell the bank, this is not the user that is doing this, this is a fraudster that does the action now in the session. And we, in the last year, do this also for account opening, allowing credit card issuers. We tell them that the person that submits now the application on the site is indeed the person that he's claiming to be, and not someone that stole the personal data, stole or bought the personal data. So everything we do had to do with the behavior of the user and understanding that if that's a user, or that's fraud. And when we started to try to solve vishing, the problem is that this is actually the user that does everything. It's coming from the user device, it's his machine, it's his IP address, and he's actually doing the session. He's transferring the money, someone social engineering him to do all those actions, but he's the guy, he's the person that actually does that. So in terms of behavioral biometrics, it's his movements on that site. So the challenge was to find within that behavior minute differences between the regular session of that user, previous sessions, and the behavior on sessions when he's on the phone with someone persuading him to do. And I'll give you four examples of things that we found. So the usual suspect was dead time on the session. So if you are logging in a regular session to your bank, you just go through some process, some actions, and you're done, okay? If you are on the phone with someone that persuades you, that instructs you, etc., you'll have dead time on the session when you are on the phone and the site basically waits for what you're going to do. So, and you see kind of, you know, distribution of dead time in APP, authorized push payment session versus regular sessions. But this is an example of relatively strong signal, but if we use that, anytime we as a genuine users would access the bank and will be distracted by a phone call or doing some other things, multitasking, we will alert the bank that the phishing is going on. This is, of course, not what we want to do. Okay? So that's a strong signal, but also a noisy signal, because that can potentially create a lot of false positives, us alerting the bank when it's not the case. Another example, and this is kind of gets to the weaker signals, is what happens if you make a mistake in the session. So let's say that you are in a genuine session, you are transferring money to another account, and you need to put in 8 digit of the account number at the other side. So you put you have the number in front of you, you put the number, you then look and you see a mistake. What most users will do is they'll wipe the whole thing clean and they'll start all over. In a phishing session, you're on the phone, you're being dictated the number, so the fraudster will tell you at the end, please read that number back to me. You'll read the number and then the fraudster will say, no, it's not a 4, it's a 5. And then you'll go to that location and just fix that specific mistake, okay? So again, a small difference in behavior, that's the end user that does that, but a small difference of behavior between the genuine session and a fraud session. Another example is we measure the time of the click of the transfer at the end of the session. So the end user gets to the point of transferring money, they click the button. In a genuine session, by that time they click it quickly, it's about 100 milliseconds. In phishing sessions, it takes not much more, but 50 milliseconds more. They click and slightly hesitate when they click. Something in the back of the mind tells them that this is, you know, something weird. Again, very weak signal, but we find 300 of those signals that together create a really strong prediction of an APP. And the last thing is we look at the orientation and movement of the device if it's on the mobile phone. So if you are on a mobile phone and you do whatever you do in a regular thing, you know, it's quite stable and it's always held like this, horizontally. But if you're being dictated over the phone an account number, so it goes like this. And then in specific portion of the session, we see a movement of the phone and a displacement change of the phone, and which is a great indication of phishing. So we launched that about a month ago. That's the first anti-fraud, anti-social engineering solution. We launched that in the UK. All the major banks are using that, and we're having fun taking that across the world. Thank you.
Gadi. Sorry, I said in Hebrew, come sit here. Okay, now I'm inviting Asaf Lifshitz to the stage from Sayata Labs. I'm sorry, that was a mistake. Marcus, it was supposed to come up. You're coming up after. Sorry about that.
Thank you. Yeah, otherwise you will see my face and the different person standing on stage, and then it will definitely say, oh, the Arcor system was hacked, which is not true. So everything is okay. And talking about presentations, it's weird because in next session, I'm gonna present my company in Oren 3 Hall. So if you'd like to see company presentation, you're welcome to come. So I will use this opportunity not to talk about the company, but actually about the current situation. We talked about hacked cars and devices. And I think we all see that in the last 5 years, things have changed. In the last 5 years, the world of cybersecurity is not about viruses or defacing websites. It's about causing real damage, making real money. And by the way, we're always proud about Made in Israel, according to foreign press. Stuxnet, have you heard about it? The virus that changed the speed of the centrifuges in Iran had something to do, again, according to the foreign press, with Israel. And then, obviously, we all heard about Russians, Black Bear, power plants in Ukraine, elections in Estonia. But actually, it came in much close to us. If you think about it, there is an enormous amount of data today in the world. Financial organizations, for example, have access to all the data they want, including KYC, know your customer information. The firewalls are there, security solutions are there, antivirus solutions are there, and still it looks like there are more and more damage. And again, if we talk about something that's really close to us, to people that sit here, financial institutions being hacked and losing money, and we every day hear stories about billions of dollars being stolen. North Korea financed this activity by stealing money. $81 million have been stolen for Bank of Bangladesh using SWIFT network. Deutsche Bank CEO had to resign. Danske Bank was fired because of money laundering. And if you think about it, it happens more and more because the world of financial crime has changed as well. Now it's financial cybercrime. Today, nobody will try to steal money by coming to a bank and trying to shoot in there. They will put a server somewhere in a remote country that will steal only 25 cents from your bank account. And by the way, when it happens, nobody complains, especially if I call it an iTunes transaction. Think about yourself. But then this server will run artificial intelligence. It will do it hundreds of millions of times in a month. And then these guys will take $20, $40 million, disconnect the link and disappear. And when the money is used just for the fraudulent activities, it's bad. But sometimes the money is used for money laundering. And today, money laundering, it's about much severe damage. It's about terrorist funding, narco traffic, human trafficking. And the interesting question is, why it keep happening? Why existing systems cannot discover it? And the answer is because existing systems, and I will talk more about it in my next presentation, but existing systems are all based on rules and thresholds and signatures and existing information. And even the what they call neural networks are very limited. You know, I take a neural network, I show it a million pictures of a rabbit, and then neural network will identify all the rabbits in the world. But show it a snake or show it a scorpion, it will totally miss it because nobody taught the system how scorpion looks like. Now, poor banks, they don't want to get fines because of money laundering. They don't want to finance terrorist activities. So they do what they call anomaly detection, basically creating huge number of false alarms. It's like saying, show me everything that is not a rabbit. By the way, it happens to not only to banks. If you heard about Target attack, I believe 65 million credit cards were stolen, or 165. Mm-hmm. But the point is that I had a chance to chat with a CIO that was forced to leave the ban, to leave Target, and they had 25,000 alerts every month. It's impossible to analyze all those alerts. And of course, the company that provided them a security solution said, oh, we were okay, you know, the system did detect this attack. So there is a need for a different solution. We use what we call intuitive AI that works more like human intuition and identifies those threats. And I thought, what kind of example I can give you to scare you, but also to make sure that you take some value from this presentation. Would you like to know how to make money by stealing money from ATMs? Good. So when people think about ATM, they think it's some financial device, but it's not. It's an IoT device. It's connected to the internet. Next time you go to some shop, look at the ATM. It's connected to an Ethernet connection, what they call. Sometimes it's wireless. And you can understand that everything that is connected to the internet connected to that device as well. So bad guys found that it's very easy to hack into the ATM. If you will open ATM, and you can visit ATM in our office, you will see that it's a very protected device. There is a safe. The motor that dispenses the money calls dispenser is very well protected. But the computer that controls it, it's outside the safe. Everybody, or almost everybody, can touch it. You can put thumb drive. You can hack this computer from remote. And that's exactly what bad guys did. They hacked the computers of the ATMs. And then you literally put a server somewhere in a remote country. Every time you push a button, money comes out of the ATM somewhere in the middle of New York, Tel Aviv, or any other place. Sounds like science fiction, right? It's not. Over $1 billion have been stolen this way. Europol published recently research about it. Over $1 billion. Very smart, organized crime. They never stole more than $5 from a single ATM. Five notes, and there are usually 10,000 notes, so nobody pay attention. And they also erased all the traces. They shut down the camera. Perfect crime. All you need is some local criminal money mule, they call them, these guys that will collect the money. And unfortunately, this money was converted into Bitcoin and used to finance human trafficking. So the lives that have been lost due to this event. So that's in a nutshell things that we do and we help solving. By the way, I'm serious. If you want to steal money from ATMs, it's much easier than you think, but don't try it at home, because there are companies like ours that will report you. So I just want to finish, because I have like 30 seconds, with a thought. Some people told me, yeah, but you know, you create intuitive AI, you make computers that have intuition and gut feelings and common sense. Isn't it dangerous? Maybe these computers will become the bad guys, the bad computers. So my answer is that every time a new innovation came, people were concerned about it. Think about cars, internet. People said that it will change the way we sort of interact with each other. It's true. But the point is that bad guys are using artificial intelligence already to steal money from us, to shut down our devices. So we as human beings have the obligation to make use of artificial intelligence and train it to help us. And it's a great pleasure to be in a company that uses artificial intelligence to make a world a much safer place, which is the theme that John Medved created, impact business and impact investment. So thank you very much, and you're welcome to my next session in Orange 3. Thank you.
Stay here. Sit down. And now I'd like to invite to stage Asaf from Sayata Labs.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Pleasure to be here. My name is Asaf Lifshitz. I'm the CEO of Sayata Labs. What we do at Sayata Labs is we help the cyber insurance industry address this very particular and complex risk. So it's a little bit different than cybersecurity, but I'll tell you all about that. So we'll start with what is cyber insurance, and then we'll get to how it's transforming. Similarly, not necessarily linked, but how it is transforming the world of cybersecurity. A little bit about what the concept of cyber insurance is. So generally, you start off with a base risk, okay? And you do mitigatory actions, ideally, you hope, that reduces your level of risk. That's true for cyber, but that's also true for almost any other type of risk. So for cyber risk, you install firewalls or you install antiviruses. With fire risk, you install sprinkler systems. But you're always left with some residual level of risk. And so what you can do is you can buy an insurance policy. So this, you're buying technology and cybersecurity, but you can also buy an insurance policy. So you're buying a contract that transfers that risk to someone else, to another entity, most likely an insurance company. And this concept is complementary. It's a complementary approach to mitigation, which is what most of cybersecurity deals with today. But stay tuned for why I think that the two will be linked in a little bit. It's been a commercial success, okay? This concept of, yes, do all the mitigatory actions, but also buy insurance. It's already, in 2018, it was estimated to be $5 billion in premiums worldwide. That, by the way, so doubling every 2.5 years, roughly, that, by the way, has been the case despite, on average, prices decreasing. So a huge, huge commercial success, partly driven by the fact, I guess, that there's been some shift in focus, both from an offering, but also how it's marketed. It used to be more a thing that you would buy as a entity, as an organization that holds access to many, many, many customer records, so personally identifiable records. So it was much more about that type of coverage, right? So if you tend to hold like a million records, 10 million records, like a big US retailer, that's a type of organization that would buy it. Over time, though, there's been a shift to offering, emphasizing more the business interruption component, okay? So what that means is that if your systems are hacked, right, good chance that you cannot operate. And you presumably have some fixed costs, and therefore, if you can't generate any revenue, you can't work, you're experiencing losses that are could be called business interruption. And so that applies to pretty much any organization. So today, pretty much any organization, at least in the developed world, is dependent on their IT or their OT. Okay, so that is part of what drove a lot of the growth. And today, at least in my opinion, the vast majority of organizations should seriously consider. They are exposed to this risk and should seriously consider insuring themselves against it. It on top of all the mitigation activities that they do. Now, but that is just. I want to put that in a broader context of all sorts of trends, right, or the challenges/opportunities that this industry is facing. And I think my take is that it's mostly driven by the fact that the ground is shifting underneath our feet in the insurance industry. So take fire risk. That's pretty much been the same to a large extent for maybe 100 years. Okay, yes, there's been some changes, but cyber risk, that's totally different. Cloud environment, like organizations are moving the computing infrastructure to the cloud. Regulations are changing. Ransomware is becoming a thing. Social engineering is evolving. Like that whole thing, right, just creates such a weird dynamic that you have to constantly adapt to. And so that raises questions or challenges for insurers. For example, the one that we described earlier, what coverage do organizations want to buy? Right, what would be an attractive insurance offering for them? So what are the risks that they're exposed to? So that's what they want to buy, but you're also curious as an insurance industry, what do you want to sell? So part of that is what should be the price, but another component is the systemic risk. Okay, so this is an interesting notion in cyber insurance. When, for example, say, let's talk about cloud environments. A lot of organizations are exposed to, say, a scenario where there's a cloud outage. And so in theory, you might want to sell a lot of insurance against a cloud outage to cover a lot of businesses in the case of cloud outage. But because that market is so consolidated, okay, what that means is there's almost this single point of failure, right? Say that all of AWS goes down for 10 days. All of a sudden, an insurance company would have to pay maybe billions of dollars. It could put some insurance companies out of business. So that's just one example of an issue that I wanted to give you guys a taste of that the cyber insurance industry is spending time thinking about. And lastly, why I do think that this is a good fit with or should be interesting to people that are interested in cybersecurity, because I think the two are a little bit linked. And the reason is the following. The cybersecurity actions, we can all agree, or at least we would hope, that whatever actions we take, they drive our cyber risk, okay? And in a competitive environment, sophisticated insurers would make that impact your premium. Okay, so we definitely can agree that insurance industry is impacted by the cybersecurity industry. But I actually argue that that it's also the other way around, and increasingly will be the case. And the reason is that at the very superficial level, if you are an organization trying to make decisions, right, determine what your actions are going to be. If you're trying to make decisions, at the superficial level, maybe you should do whatever reduces your premium. Okay, that's that would be one of the factors in your decision making. But I would argue it's not just for saving money. I think that the advice that you'd be getting from the insurance industry over time is exactly the type of advice I think that you want, because this is an advisor who's locked interest with you. Okay, this is an advisor who will actually foot the bill if something happens, unlike almost any other advisor that you might hire. Definitely almost all of the cybersecurity vendors that are pitching to you what your security actions should be. And so that's why I think that over time, the cybersecurity industry really has to to understand more how the cyber insurance industry thinks. Thanks very much.
Keep the microphone. Okay, so thank you, everybody. Now we're actually going to be shifting gears to the panel element of this session. Since we were a bit delayed, I guess we're just going to run the clock, and if you start doing jumping jacks, we'll slow down. Does that sound okay? All right, awesome. So first off, I'm honored to be here amongst you guys. This is a very exciting group, very diverse. We have focus on the automobile space, we have helping with digital identities, we have focus on financial fraud, and we have the insurance space. So it just really goes to show you how broad the cyberspace really can be. What I actually gathered here is a nice list of questions from people who were curious and really wanted to ask you guys kind of, even though Israel has this amazing name in the cybersecurity space, how are you guys doing this, right? So you are startups trying to sell your product and targeting these massive enterprises. So how do you go about doing something like that?
Should I start?
Sure.
Yeah, so it's a very good question. Our customers are companies like Citigroup, Santander Group, ABN AMRO, BNP Paribas, the largest banks in the world. And it's a good question, how we as a small startup can do it out of Israel. And I will start by saying what I said to all my salespeople, all those banks would rather buy from IBM than from me. But we need to do something that is different, something that others cannot do. And there is one area that we in Israel really have to develop very well. I guess for the guests here, you know that Israel is a beautiful place, but we're surrounded by people that don't like us so much.
Yeah.
And French people say that there is nothing like guillotine to sharpen your mind. So we just show them that we can do better than others, and then we prove that we can do better than others. We don't make a mistake of charging lower prices. We actually try to charge more than large organizations to position ourselves as a real real solution. And luckily, when we show results, the ROI, the return on investment, is so high that they gladly do it. But it's definitely a challenge.
Thank you. And then I'd love to hear how such a kind of old school space like the automotive industry, how do you convince them to innovate and really push forward and really take this all into mind?
So it turns out that the automotive industry is looking for solutions. And as they say in the UK, the proof is in the pudding. If you are able to show them that you can solve their problem better than anyone else, then they're willing to listen to you. It's not a matter of PowerPoint. You actually have to prove it to them and show them that you've solved the problem, and then they're willing to talk to you. And the reason is because there's nowhere else to go.
That's very fair. Okay, if nobody else wants to jump on that, we'll move forward. So it appears that kind of the impact that AI is having on both the attacked and defense side is kind of changing the entire perspective on this industry. I'd love to hear some insights, obviously, in the digital identity space. That's really valuable. So
I think I'll be careful here, but I think that AI, in many cases, is basically rebranding of statistics. In many implementations, the whole notion of I'm just dumping the raw data into some engine and the engine decides for me is not going to work. Either you don't have enough data, or you don't have enough power, or you're missing the cognitive element that, in our space of really understanding what's behind the data and what drives that and what features I need to extract. Once you do this, once you understand your space and you get the information out of the raw data, of course you're going to use the classifiers and AI and engines to optimize the performance. But I'm less concerned about, you know, startups that basically will just get access to all this data and some machines will tell them what the algorithms are. And also, I mean, for us, we now have tens of customers, we sit on the data. So the data access, the ability to get the data and build models on top of that, that's the kind of competition blocking factor versus a small startup now that needs to persuade Lloyd's to install something that will feed the data to their machines.
Phenomenal.
You asked to make sure that this panel will be a little bit alive. So I have to jump in and disagree. And by the way, you said it's just a random statistic and people start leaving the hall. yeah, we have a different view. Of course, we are good friends, but just for the sake of the discussion, we have a different view. One of our founders, Professor Koifman, do it for 20 years. Recipient of Golden Medal of Science by Clinton, professor at Yale, 20 years on the advisory board of DARPA. And it's true, today every new statistical algorithm, people call it AI because it's a great way to raise a little bit more money. I do believe that, and there is a great definition of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is the ability for computers to do something that if people will do, somebody will say that person is intelligent. and that's what we're trying to do. I think this is the new world of artificial intelligence. You know, the analytic part, cortex in our brain, is just a very small part of our brain. Most of our brain is subconscious.
It's where we make those fast decisions. When we recognize faces, when we see lions, and then there is a fight or flight decision. It's what we call intuition, common sense. I believe that this is the future of AI. Of course, I'm not objective because that's what we do. And thanks to our crowd, also raised quite a large amount of money, and customers are using it. I do believe that the future of AI is with us. I do believe that organizations that will not jump on artificial intelligence bandwagon will be left behind. And I think that we as good guys will use AI. Unfortunately, bad guys already have very advanced AI. They don't have any laws, ethics. And if they ask a professor in the respective country to give them the algorithms, usually the IP protection doesn't work, if you understand what I mean by that. If criminal guys ask nicely.
Absolutely. Okay, and so that kind of leads into, so are there some overarching trends in 2019 that we think are really making a big difference in this world?
Everyone talking about AI. That's a trend.
And then Asaf, what
yeah,
about?
Yeah, so maybe another comment on AI that I found in, at the very least interesting, that attackers could also use AI, you could imagine, right? And I'm going to use that term loosely. And one scenario that was articulated by a person that I talked to was, what if you can get a lot of individuals? So the email that was discussed this morning, right, that was sent, right? That was probably a person behind that. And so they're very limited by their capacity to send out these emails and compromise accounts. But maybe with AI, you're not going to do as well as a person to try to extract money or get people to behave in a way that you want them, but you can do it at a massive scale, okay? So all of a sudden this, you could look at an example like Google Duplex, okay? I'm not sure if the people in the audience are familiar with it, but that's the Google system for automatically all AI discussion with a restaurant to make a reservation, okay? That could have impact in how social engineering could work. Right, so all of a sudden, this is a tool for attackers to operate at vast, vast scale. So I think I just think it's an interesting perspective from more of a threat, not how we mitigate it perspective.
Thank you. And then, so a lot of people are now freaking out about the operational technology space. So whether it is, like in that example that we showed, a connected medical device, manufacturing facilities, IoT like ATMs or automobiles or whatnot, there's kind of this consensus that a lot of those attacks tend to be from nation states. Do we believe that that's actually true?
Yeah, the answer is yes, it's true. And I will start with the positive view, okay? We have great units in Israel, people that serving those units get a great experience, and then the ecosystem of VCs, academy, military, and of course multinationals creates this amazing opportunity for people to create companies like Checkpoint or others, or CyberArk, or all the companies that we know. Now, in the other stations have the same abilities, not as good as Israelis, of course, but many rogue nations have pretty good abilities, cyber abilities. The Syrian Liberation Army are not bad at all, and of course Iranians are very, very professional. The point is that people that serve in those organizations, government-led organizations, first of all, provide a lot of experience, but unfortunately when they leave the organization, they build their own startups. But in their case, they're not startups like Checkpoint to Protect. It's more like startups that help them to convert the knowledge into money. And I mentioned a few, according to Interpol report, the $1 billion scheme with ATMs was originated in Russia, although it happened, the center was in Spain. So bottom line, governments do it, and most of the very experienced attackers actually can be pinpointed, or the source of the knowledge can be pinpointed to government organizations.
Thank you. And then I don't see jumping jacks yet, so I'm just going to keep on going. have you seen in each one of your respective companies an impact from any of the new regulations that have been coming out? Has it been kind of pushing customers towards you?
So the new regulation specifically in Europe of PSD2 and strong customer authentication is really a driving force for us, because now the banking industry wants to open their systems and to do this, or the governments want their banking clients to open their systems and to do this, there's an increased regulation on the type of authentication that they need to implement. And we provide basically the only authentication method that is frictionless. So if you do behavioral biometric authentication, there's nothing that the end user himself needs to do except what he is doing anyway with the site. So we're seeing this really as a tailwind of adoption of behavioral because of that requirement to have second authentication methods.
Awesome. Are we seeing any regulation in the automotive space or not yet?
So there are legislation committees, both in the US and in Europe, that are talking about cybersecurity for automotive. Until now, it hasn't been legislated. It's not compulsory, but it's advice. We are seeing as well, for example, the US CERT, put out warnings about different types of attacks on vehicles, and they give some mitigation advice about what to do about it. Not very helpful usually, that mitigation advice, but it's becoming more and more discussed on government levels and legislation levels, and the ISO committees are now doing legislation or specifications for cybersecurity in vehicles, and they're going to be published soon.
So it's still in development, there's nothing really.
It's in the working, it's in the making.
Absolutely. Okay. Well, I'd like to thank everybody for coming here, especially our speakers, and I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the summit.